Today, we write messages by tapping on glass screens. But for thousands of years, quill pens like this one were the norm. The Dead Sea Scrolls, the Magna Carta, the Declaration of Independence, all written with quills torn from live geese's bodies. Now, until the 19th century, the literate world required huge numbers of geese in order to keep people writing. And all of these geese were subjected to live flucking that is not that pleasant. And it was very violent, very inhumane. In fact, today's anti-cruelty laws would prohibit it. Yet, it wasn't humane sentiment nor sustainability concerns that spared geese from such an undesirable fate. Rather, the invention of the metal fountain pen was good for the goose and good for the gander. With the newfound ability to write sentences uninterrupted by the need to stop and dip your quill into an inkwell and sharpen the quill tip, we now have the ability to continue to write in ways that were so much preferable to the way that we had written before that the metal fountain pen quickly rendered the quill pen a relic of an archaic past. Today, we face yet another opportunity to render a distasteful practice obsolete. And yet again today, it has to do with geese. But the problem is much bigger than geese. The problem today is that we are using vast numbers of geese, ducks, chickens, turkeys, pigs, cows, and other animals who we frankly really like to eat. Now, obviously, this is a big problem for those animals, but it's especially a big problem for us and an even bigger problem for the planet. Because the planet is not getting any bigger. Humanity's footprint on the planet is getting a lot bigger, but the planet itself remains the same size. And one of the primary ways that we leave that footprint is through our food print, principally in the amount of meat that we eat. It's no longer a secret that it just takes a lot of land, a lot of water, a lot of energy, and a lot of greenhouse gas emissions to raise and slaughter billions of animals for food compared to just eating plants directly. Using animals for food is the number one driver of deforestation, the number one driver of wildlife extinction, and a whole host of other environmental crises that we face today. As just one example, consider the fact that animal agriculture contributes more greenhouse gas emissions than the entirety of the transportation sector combined. Let that sink in. Using animals for food contributes more to greenhouse gas emissions than all cars, all trucks, all planes, all boats, and all trains all combined. Now, of course, we all know that it would be better for us to enjoy more plant-based meals and eat fewer animals. That would be great. Unfortunately, that's not what's happening. What's happening is the meat demand is going up, not down. It's going up because, yes, we are adding more people to the planet, which of course increases total demand, but it's especially going up because, on a per-person basis, we are eating more meat today than we ever have been in all of human history prior. It would be wonderful if we wanted to enjoy more lentil soup and rice and bean burritos and hummus wraps. These are great foods. I wish we would eat more of them. But I also wish people would walk and bike more, yet people seem to really want to drive. So we need to make cars that don't rely on fossil fuels. Similarly, people seem to really want to eat meat. So we must find ways to recreate the meat experience without animals. Just in the same way that the metal fountain pen allowed us to continue writing, but in a way that was much more efficient than we had written for millennia prior, the task before humanity today must be to find ways to continue to allow ourselves to enjoy the experience of eating meat, but in a way that uses way less land, way less water, way fewer greenhouse gas emissions, and of course, in a way that doesn't harm animals. That is how we can efficiently enjoy the meat experience. Well, good news. There are many ways to recreate meat, just as there are many ways to get energy without fossil fuels. Think wind, solar, geothermal, nuclear, and more. Well, there's lots of ways to recreate the meat experience without animals. Already, many companies are turning plant proteins into things that look like animal meat and that taste like animal meat, and these are great. These plant-based meats aren't fake meat any more than a metal fountain pen is a fake quill. It's just a new way to enjoy the meat experience. But there are some limitations to using plant proteins, mainly because plants and animals are really far away from one another on the tree of life. So you need to do a lot to plants to make them look and taste like animals. So some companies instead are just cultivating actual animal cells and growing animal meat without the animals. This field is sometimes referred to as cultivated meat or clean meat, and it is awesome. It's such a cool technology. Unfortunately, it is still many years away from being able to sell this stuff on fast food menus or big box grocery store shelves, which is of course the type of scale that is needed in order to make a dent in the problem that we are trying to solve. But there is a third way, and yes, I am talking about the F word. Fungi, of course, but not just any fungi. We're not talking here about mushrooms. We're talking about microscopic fungi, sometimes referred to as mycelium, that, as you can see here at a 40x magnification, doesn't look like a mushroom at all because it's not. Rather, as you can see here, we've dyed the fungi red, and what's been dyed purple is actually byproducts from a French fry processing facility. Now, I'll explain in a minute why this is so important, but for now, just know that the fungi is eating the potatoes. Now, we'll go back to grade school biology class for a moment here and remind ourselves that, yes, there are the kingdoms of plant and animal, but there's also another kingdom, the fantastic world of fungi. And interestingly enough, fungi and animals are way closer to one another than either is to plants. Interestingly, many cultures have been using mushrooms as a meat alternative for many centuries because many species of mushrooms have a far more meat-like texture than do plants, that the plants typically do. Now, again, though, we're not talking about mushrooms, we are talking about mycelium, the filamental root-like structure that carpets much of the earth that is made of fungi. And fortuitously, there are many species of fungi whose flesh, so to speak, is already textured like animal flesh, and it's packed with protein, zinc, iron, and other nutrients that we typically associate with animal-based meat. So we'll go back to our friendly fungi that's been magnified 40x, and I want to show you what this looks like and why it's important if we go a little bit deeper. So I'm going to show you what it looks like at 100x, just so you can get a sense of what's actually happening and why it's important. So as you can see, when you go here, what's happening is that we can feed the byproducts of the agricultural industry, like corn, potato, and rice, to microscopic fungi who turned it into mycelium that on its own, in its natural whole food, unprocessed state, already has the texture of meat and the nutritional qualities of meat that we are seeking. And the result is frankly amazing. Let me show you some of the applications that we can make from this mycelium at my startup, The Better Meat Co. For example, we can make a succulent chicken breast made from mycelium without the chicken, or a delicious turkey deli slice sandwich without the turkey, or a steak that can satisfy even the most inveterate carnivore. And yes, for our friends in the geese community who are happy to be keeping their quills because we no longer need them, they too can now keep their livers because we can make a microbial, delectable foie gras that will satisfy even the most stingy gourmand. In other words, by using fungi to replace animal-based meat, we can allow ourselves to continue enjoying the experience of meat consumption, but in a way that takes far fewer resources. And importantly, we can grow this type of product in stainless steel tanks that resemble craft breweries, except instead of brewing alcohol, we are brewing protein. And unlike a cow who needs more than a year of feeding before you get a steak, we can harvest our little microbial fungi in less than one single day. That's right, from the time we inoculate our fermenter to the time we harvest our fermenter can occur in less than one single day, making this among the most efficient ways to produce protein on a planet that is increasingly hungry, meaning that we can continue enjoying the meat experience in a way that uses less land, less water, fewer greenhouse gas emissions, and yes, it is also dramatically more humane to animals. And just in the same way that metal fountain pens weren't mere quill mimicry, they are better than quills, we now have the opportunity to utilize microbial fermentation of fungi to not only slash humanity's footprint on the planet, but also to create all types of novel culinary experiences that we've never before enjoyed. What if, for example, you could, just in the same way that you might have a bread maker or an ice cream maker on your kitchen counter today, you happen to have your own meat maker. And you could just order tea bags full of fungi spores that you drop in and come back the next day to get freshly brewed meat. Or maybe you'll go to your local restaurant and just like they're brewing their own IPA in the back, They happen to be brewing your dinner that night, local, artisanal meat made just for you. Or what if we do ever figure out how to depart from our pale blue dot? You can rest assured that if we are ever engaged in cosmic tourism, we're not going to be carrying Noah's Ark in tow. If long-distance astronauts want to eat meat, they're going to have to grow it. Technology has changed so much about how we live here on Earth. Instead of whipping horses, we now use bikes and cars. Instead of harpooning whales, we now use electricity. And instead of live-plucking geese, we now tap on glass screens. All of these inventions at first, of course, seem so odd and foreign to us. Recall, for example, that what we now know as cars were originally referred to as horseless carriages. But eventually, we come to recognize the new technology as so superior that we switch to it en masse and we hardly remember what life was like once prior to the new invention. Just imagine how shocked you would be if somebody who you knew today relied on horses for transportation, or whales for lighting, or geese for writing. Well, I believe that technologies like microbial fungi fermentation are going to allow our descendants the ability to also express shock if somebody they know chooses to slaughter animals rather than utilize the obviously superior technology that has been invented. Microbial fungi fermentation is just one way to liberate humanity from our reliance on animal slaughter, but it is a critically important, cost-effective, and scalable solution to this vexing problem of how we are going to sustainably feed ourselves into the 21st century. We only have one planet, and we shouldn't deforest the rest of it simply so we can continue to eat more and more animals. Instead, just as we must end our reliance on fossil fuels, so too must we end our reliance on factory farms. Today, the only place that you are likely to find a quill pen is inside of a museum. The time has come for us similarly to leave the factory farming of animals where it too belongs, in our past. Thank you.